Tony, thank you for agreeing to do this video interview with us today. For our video audience, would you please introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure, I'd be glad to. My name is Tony Moore, and I'm from Massillon, Ohio, in the United States.
And how did you first come across this thing we call Human Performance Technology, HPT?
Interesting story. I had been originally involved in ASTD as a young man. Mm-hmm. I had hair in those days. And I just never felt like I felt in, but I assumed it was because I was naive and didn't understand what I was doing. But all these other silverheads were so enthusiastic about what they were doing and seemed to think it was great. I just didn't understand it. Mm-hmm. But I got their journal, which was glossy and colorful, mm-hmm. And didn't understand it either. But one day I found a little tiny ad about an ISBI conference in Chicago.
Uh-huh.
It was in the early 80s. I can't remember when mm-hmm. exactly, but it was early 80s. And I got all excited, and I had a friend in another training department in the company, and I went, I ran to his building and said, "Look what I found. This sounds really interesting." And he gives a yawn. He says, "Ho-hum." He says, "I've been a member of that organization for years. Would you like to read their journals?" And there was a quarterly thing they did. I don't remember its name. It was a little bit
yes.
different, but it was real academic and full of research.
Right.
So I took those home and read them, and I came back up, and I says, "We have to go to this. We have to go to this." So Andy and I went to the conference, and it was immediately apparent to me. They had a special session for newcomers.
Newcomers, right. Introduction to HPT.
And more about that later.
Mm-hmm.
But I just knew I fit in. This became immediately my professional home. And mm-hmm. they thought like I did, data-driven, and I used to be a science teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And it just made immediately such good sense. So that was my early experience, and I've never looked back, and I've never regretted it.
Well, besides being introduced to probably Performance Improvement Quarterly, which is our quarterly referee journal, who would you attribute as your biggest influences in the society, in the technology? Who are the people or the books or the articles that you might recommend to others to take a look at?
Oh, well, my first exposure was Bob Mager's books.
Okay.
Short, fun to read,
mm-hmm.
right on the money, but without all the technical jibber-jabber,
mm-hmm.
And with a great sense of humor. But they were my first introduction, and it took me, I mentioned earlier, I was a teacher. And these raised me, once I'd gone into business and industry, they helped me then make the transition to being a trainer.
Mm-hmm.
And also learn to do front-end analysis, but of course the Mager way.
The Mager way, right.
Initially. And the Goal Analysis, wonderful book.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my first introduction, really, to performance technology, but it wasn't called that at the
right.
time. There may have been
structural technology was closer to that back
right,
in those
exactly.
days.
But shortly after that, I came to my first conference, and I met Joe Harless.
Mm-hmm.
And Joe, like all the others, you know, who had that name recognition and familiarity, the big names in the business, mm-hmm. were so willing in the hallways. They were approachable. You could talk to them, and they didn't try and sell you a workshop, or they didn't try and sell you a book. They answered your questions, mm-hmm. and then would ask, "Did that help?" You know, it was wonderful. My other organization wouldn't do that. They wanted to sell me their books or their workshops.
Mm-hmm.
So it was so refreshing. But Joe, I just thought, boy, this guy has got something. Later on, Joe was walking down the hall. Now remember, I'm a nobody. Young, naive, and first time there, nobody knew me. I'm walking down the hall, Joe and some old man with a cane who was hobbling towards me, going somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
Joe said, "Tom, I'd like you to meet this young man." And Joe introduced me to Tom Gilbert.
Mm-hmm.
And we stand there and talk in the hall, and Tom Gilbert blew me away.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, first of all, he was so cordial and so friendly and so funny,
mm-hmm.
And so smart. So that was the start. And from there, you know, I talked to my friend that came with me from where I worked. And he said, you know, we got to get the company to send you to Joe Harless's workshops. They're wonderful. And buy Tom's book, Human Confidence. Right. So Tom's book had an impact on me. Well, now, I respected my friend Andy Fertile a lot. And Ted Krein, who was another, he was an ASTD-er, but he was the only one that made sense to me. He also had recommended Tom Gilbert. Mm-hmm. So when I read Tom the first time as a teacher, I got furious when I hit that part about the knowledge cult.
Okay.
I took it personally. I got very angry. I was in my den, threw the book on the floor. And then as I cooled off, I said, you know, two of my best friends, I shouldn't say best friends, that's overstatement, but people I respected.
Yes.
Spoke so highly of it, there must be something there. So I picked it up. I struggled through. It's not an easy read if you're trying to figure out what's being said. And at the end, there were pieces that made sense, but most of it didn't. So I reread it. Having read it the first time, now all of a sudden, things at the beginning began to make a little more sense. And I thought, well, that's a pretty good read. Put it aside, and through the year, it had these little revelations that the way I looked at the world had now changed. Mm-hmm. And it changed because of Tom's book. A year later, I thought, I'm going to read the book again. And I did, and it was like a new book. I was seeing things I never saw in the first two reads. I did that every year for several years. And every time I read it, because of my intervening years of experience, I was able to see things. That book is written on so many levels. It'll be useful to anybody. I recommend it highly.
Now, I understand in your local chapter, your ISPI chapter, that you have used this book, is this correct, as part of a book club approach to helping introduce others to human performance technology?
Exactly. About 8 years ago, we weren't happy with the direction of our chapter. Mm-hmm. And it was getting too soft, too touchy-feely. Mm-hmm. And so a friend of mine who's retired now, Bruce Backstrom, and I thought, well, we're going to volunteer for the program committee and we're going to change it. Mm-hmm. And we decided to turn that year into, we called it an HPT symposium or something of that nature for the year. And we started with a study of Tom Gilbert's book, not in a meeting. We took the kind of the Reader's Digest approach, a page a day, so about roughly 30 pages, wherever the break was appropriate.
Right.
So it might have been 28 pages, it might have been 35 pages. We averaged about 30 pages a month. And every month we studied another 30 pages chunk of Tom Gilbert and discussed it. So we had clear-cut rules based on Mortimer Adler's How to Read a Book and the Denver Great Books Club. So people read with a purpose. If they didn't get a chance to read the book, they were still welcome to come, but they weren't allowed to participate.
Aha. They could lurk.
They could lurk. Lurk and learn. the first thing that happened was we went from a large for the Cleveland area.
Yes.
From a large group to like six members. Mm-hmm. The other people who tossed off didn't like this new approach. It was too rigid for them. And so they abandoned, but I'll tell you, the meetings got excited. The little six of us, the discussions we had, amazing. When we had almost a 20-year history. We started in about mid-1980s. We formed our organization, our little chapter. And but from the 1980s up until 8 years ago, we could never get more than 9 months in a row of programming because everybody wanted the summers off for their family.
Yes.
And, that was just, you weren't going to win that argument. Well, the end of this program year came on Tom Gilbert, and we still had a couple chapters left to go. Unanimous vote. We're going to continue through the year. And we've not looked back. We've been, 12 months every year in and out. And the interesting thing was when you know, and we chose Gilbert because he kind of is the foundation of human performance mm-hmm. technology.
Although
and
there are some arguments about that.
There are other people would argue that. I'm not saying it is or isn't.
Right.
But there seems to be enough of a consensus to make it that a legitimate.
He's one of them.
Position.
Yes.
He's one
definitely.
Of them. And what it did was it gave us a common philosophy, a common language, mm-hmm. so that when we went to pick out other programs, mm-hmm. you know, we'd measure it against Tom, and mm-hmm. how did it contribute? So we got to the end of Tom's book, and we decided, okay, we achieved our goal. Let's go back to the normal, you know, let's return to regular programming.
Yes.
And another unanimous vote. We like this. Let's continue. Mm-hmm. What book would you suggest next?
Okay.
So we have gone through now, in some years we would combine books where it made sense to combine them, where they were related to each other, and so we'd study them simultaneously together.
Ah.
As we discuss the books, you've got to relate it, what you say, to the book.
Mm-hmm.
Or books we've read before.
Okay.
We've now covered almost all of the key books that laid the foundation over the years.
Not and to catch you off guard on this,
sure.
but could you identify those books for the our audience?
I can probably hit most of them.
Okay.
There was Tom Gilbert. There was Aubrey Daniels. Performance management, so mm-hmm. we can hit the. We kind of used the Six Cells and Harless's larger picture.
Yes.
Yeah, his behavior engineering to help
model.
Select mm-hmm. select books. Where you know, what cell would you like to learn more about?
Okay, excellent.
And we also used the human performance technology model.
Yes.
As another source of, you know, to keep us from wandering off into the. Soft world, mm-hmm. you know, which of these aspects would you like to learn? And then mm-hmm. we added one to it because we think something that's missing that needs to be added is the marketing and selling of your services.
Okay.
Whether you're internal or external
sure.
consultant, you need to be able to get people to buy into this. And so we added that. So we've looked at Aubrey Daniels because of the positive reinforcement aspect, mm-hmm. and it's the best book on that mm-hmm. that I've seen, full of practical examples. We did both of Bill Daniels' books, The Change Able Organization, and help me out there, his...
I don't recall.
Oh, I'm so embarrassed. It's my age.
You know? But Bill Daniels' books, he's got some great ones.
Oh,
yes.
He does. Absolutely wonderful. And again, gives you insight that is so valuable mm-hmm. and practical and usable. We've done both of Gary Rumler's books, you know, mm-hmm. the White Spaces and then the Serious Performance Consulting. Mm-hmm. We did those in consecutive years.
Yes.
Who else have we done? Oh, please, this is so embarrassing.
Oh, that's okay. Here, let me shift gears here for us. So one of the challenges for people entering in the field, and perhaps for some of us who have been around for a while, is to have a succinct way to state what it is we do for a living, or what could also be said our 30-second elevator speech on HPT. How do you explain what you do to others? What do you use? How do you say it?
Well, I basically say two things. Number one, I help clients solve critical business problems.
Mm-hmm.
That's usually my door in.
Okay.
Or if I get approached, it's do you do training or do you do motivational things?
Okay.
Okay. But they're calling because of a problem, mm-hmm. almost always. So my first thing is I say I solve critical business problems. The other thing is I help clients plan for future events in their organization, new jobs, new procedures, new processes, mm-hmm. new departments, new functions. I help them plan so they can hit the ground running mm-hmm. and so they don't create critical right. business problems in the process. So essentially, I do just two things.
Okay. Everybody's got a lot of attention on lifelong learning, and related to our profession here, do you have any current focus for extending your own learning or a future focus that you can talk about for our audience?
Well, over the years, my practice has been just like our book club. Mm-hmm. I pick areas where I want to expand my knowledge. But my current focus is a little more practical, I think. Two areas that have always been close to me. are healthcare and public education.
Okay.
And so what I'm focusing on right now is finding ways to apply HPT to those two industries, healthcare and how to help, how to apply HPT to it, and how to help the process, how to help the preparation of healthcare, kids in healthcare programs. And then in the public schools, basically inspired by Joe Harless's Eden Conspiracy, which is one of our books that we studied in the book club. So inspired by that, I've decided I'm also going to try and help get Joe's system into school systems. And to that end, I just finished a meeting in the county south of me, and now we formed a steering committee. I've been appointed the consultant for the basically education, training, and process of this thing. And the process, not like process in the industrial sense, the process of how do we get from where we are to where we need to be.
The implementation plan, the change plan.
Yeah, and our committee is made up of about two-thirds business leaders in the community. All the major industries are represented.
Is this similar to Joe's story the other day about what he's done in his county in Georgia?
Yes.
That working
yes.
with the business community because the educational system is not producing the type of graduates with the kinds of knowledge, skills, and attitudes that we need?
That is it, precisely. Now, he because of the constraints, the political and economic constraints, he was constrained to pretty much a college and career approach to the thing. And the assumption going into this by most everybody is that's what we're doing would do.
Uh-huh.
But I was shocked at this we had a one-day summit meeting between educators and superintendents of education. There's eight districts in this county.
Okay.
And the business leaders. And we kind of presented our idea. Cool reception from the educators, but they know they're in trouble. They know they're in trouble. That's a nice place to start.
Mm-hmm.
And willing to listen. They're not, they're skeptical, and should be.
Sure.
Businessmen, on the other hand, when they heard this process, also looked at it from the point of view of their fathers and mothers of children, and they liked the other aspects that had to be omitted from Joe's program. So we may end up getting closer than Joe, because they like this idea of having graduates prepared to marry and raise children, having graduates prepared to be responsible and efficient and effective and accomplished citizens.
Accomplished citizens, yes.
So
very good.
We're thrilled about the progress so far.
That's very cool, very cool. Let me shift again here to terminology, language of our profession, our internal jargon. Which I think is okay to do, but when we're talking to our clients, talk their language. But when we get amongst ourselves here and we talk, is there any particular HPT term or phrase that you'd like to clarify, that you'd like to present your definition for such a term?
Actually, there's two again.
Okay.
That I think are important. And they're not my definitions. I borrowed them from Joe.
Sure, you liberated them.
Yeah, I liberated them from Joe. I lifted them. I stole them, Joe. But I think it's critical, because I think in our profession, people still don't understand the meaning of these terms.
Okay.
And so one is the word performance itself. I mean, performance technology?
Mm-hmm.
What is performance? And everybody thinks in behavioral terms if they think at all about it.
Yes.
But Joe and Tom Gilbert, where Joe got his stuff, they're very specific. Performance is what we do on a job, but more importantly, what we produce from those things, because that's where the value of those behaviors is. Behavior is expensive. It's the things those behaviors accomplish that add the value and help you people, I call it the Rodney Dangerfield syndrome. I don't get no respect.
Yes.
Okay. Well, there's a reason for that, because you want behavior. You focus on behavior, which is costly, and business people know that.
Mm-hmm.
But business people love when you talk results, because there's value there. So I think it's an important distinction, and we need to be more sensitive to it. The other one is the word accomplishment.
Okay.
The accomplished citizen, the accomplished performer.
Mm-hmm.
What do? They produce accomplishments. And the definition of that is outputs of behavior that are valuable to the organization or to do honor to others. I think you can apply this at every level, right on up to, you know, an accomplished society or accomplishments that help society. So that word needs to be understood, and people need to understand that accomplishment is not past tense behavior. Mm-hmm. It's a thing, something that you can identify with my old, as an English teacher, among other things, you know, noun markers. You make it a single word and put an or the in front of it, and if it works, you've got a noun.
That's
the first start, and then you can pluralize it if you want after that. But so I think people need to be real comfortable identifying and stating accomplishments, because that's where you have to start: the organizational accomplishment, the job accomplishment, the task accomplishment, heck, even the step accomplishment. It gives you focus, it gives you purpose.
It's
powerful, powerful word. We need to be more careful how we use it.
Thank you. In this particular video series, our HPT Legacy series, part of our intent is to capture stories from the past, going back into the days of NSPI or ISPI, depending on when your entree to the society was. And so if you have some stories to share about people or events or both that you could share with our audience to kind of bring the past alive today, what would those be?
I think the very first one would be Joe Harless's Wizard of Noonan speech, which you have on video.
Yes, so we've posted that online, yes.
But you need to put the
URL on,
that people can get to it, because it's as you said earlier, the audio is very difficult to understand.
And some of the video is not
a little,
the greatest,
yeah,
but it's a homemade movie. So
handheld camera in the back of the room. But please stick with it. Joe is just a master at the business, but he's a great presenter. He's incredibly funny. I delighted in how he poked fun at his colleagues, his dear friends.
Yes, it was a roast in reverse.
A roast in reverse, and it was wonderfully done. And I don't think I've ever laughed as hard, tears down my face from this thing. And of course, it helps if you know who he's talking about.
Exactly,
you know?
Yes.
And but it was a delightful event. It was a highlight of, I think, all of, not in terms of what I've learned, but the fun I've had. So that's one. I think another one that it deals with an individual, a wonderful young lady. I haven't seen her in years. I mean, she's probably retired now, but it was at that first conference. And she was at this little, it was my second conference, and by that time we'd formed our chapter, and I was a chapter leader. So I had come to what is now the chapter leader workshop.
Yes.
This was designed to help guys
new
like
chapters,
me, new
yeah,
chapter
right.
people. And there was a young lady called Amy Titus.
Yes.
You know Amy? I think Tidewater, wasn't she?
I remember her. I can't recall exactly, but I do recall her.
As I recall, she also was kind of international, and so she did a lot of her work on Colin Carroll Panza does in other countries. But I asked her, because again, I was fresh out of ASTD and ISPI, and into ISPI, or NSPI in those days. So I asked her, what's the difference? She had a delightful analogy. And it, basically, she said, ASTD is like the National Council of Churches. To become a member of the National Council of Churches, you have to be a member of a church. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter which church or what the theology is, just as long as you worship somewhere, somehow. We don't care how or where. ISPI, on the other hand, is like one of those churches, like one of those denominations. And ISPI has a way to worship, you know, or a way to approach the work, and it's data driven and systematic and rigorous, and and that's a wonderful analogy. I mean, it really kind of shows how we're different without denigrating ASTD. You know, it just says we kind of serve different audiences in different ways, and it also, I think, is enlightening from a chapter point of view, in that. You know, a chapter like a church, you know, has a flock it has to attend to. And we have kind of a missionary value too. You know, we want to go out and convert people.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But when we welcome new members, we welcome them because they want to be like us and they come to learn.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, if we get a new member who wants us to be like him or her,
right?
You know, comes in and says, well, this is the way you should be doing it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, there are other churches. Go
right.
find one.
Right.
You know,
mm-hmm.
I do not hesitate to uninvite members
mm-hmm.
Because we've been 20 years through that, and only in the last 8 years have we been able to focus our membership.
Mm-hmm.
When new members come in, we have them introduce themselves, tell us about themselves,
mm-hmm.
and then we introduce ourselves. And we say, here's what we're about, and if this isn't what you're for, you know, if you never show up again, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not
right.
meant for everybody, but we, frankly, we don't want you if you're not interested in our approach. Now, if you are interested, one of the things we insist is that you be intimate with Tom Gilbert's human competence.
Mm-hmm.
We will assign somebody to work with you as you read your way through.
Mm-hmm.
And invariably, we end up getting more than one.
Uh-huh.
And we do it online, and we sign reading to those people. That, so mm-hmm. they're doing two books. They're doing the one that we're working on currently, as well as Tom
playing
Gilbert.
Catch up with
and playing catch up on with Tom Gilbert.
Well, I like what you're saying here, because as ASTD is fundamentally a trade organization. They represent the trade.
Oh, yeah.
And there's people in ISPI who would say that we are a members organization, but that's not true. We are a members organization, secondly. First, we are a technology organization, as Dale Breithauer would tell us all, that we are technology-driven. So if our members want something that violates the technology, the application of science, which is what technology is, not computers, that we cannot serve the members' needs, wants, and desires, because if it violates the science, then we're not interested in that. So we are a technology-driven organization first, a members-driven organization second. But we must remain true to the technology, which is, it's exciting that everybody at this particular conference, because we're doing this at the 2012 conference, at the 50th anniversary of the society, and there's been a lot at this conference talking about promoting, nudging us back to evidence-based practice, EBP, which is newfangled term for what used to be called back in the day when I first joined, research based and measured results. So if they mean the same thing, it's just newer terms today, I'm very happy about that. But that's very interesting that you're doing it, the chapter, and that you've taken on that philosophy. And I would hope that more people in more chapters might embrace that kind of approach, as well as at the international organization.
I think it's worked for us. It may not work for everybody,
mm-hmm.
but it's worked for us. Like I said, we went down to 6 people.
Mm-hmm.
We're growing.
Mm-hmm.
We're growing slowly and carefully.
Mm-hmm.
Our motto basically is quality over quantity.
Mm-hmm.
We want to grow, but that's not our goal.
I think when we talked previously about your chapter, it had grown. You're much bigger than 6. So
we're 20 now.
20 now.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, so. And a much higher percentage of our group now is our international members, as opposed to before, when early enough to maintain our charter.
Uh-huh.
Now, you know, we can just elect about just about anybody because.
Mm-hmm. They're members both of the chapter and of the international organization.
Yes.
Just to clarify for the audience,
yes.
They're not. You don't have people from Germany that are a member of your. Chapter. Yes.
But if they want to join, we do a lot. We do our winter months because of the snow in Cleveland.
Well, you're doing
winter months
virtually,
online.
So people could participate that way, which is a very interesting model, I think, for other chapters. And I'm sure you have other stories of people from the past, events from the past. You don't have.
But I'm not sure. I'm not sure they would want their stories told.
Well, we could always edit out.
There is one. I'll do it without the names. It was a conference in L.A., Los Angeles,
mm-hmm.
and we'd been through the all of the events for the day with ISPI, and a group of us decided, well, we wanted to go to a comedy club.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were going up the escalator from the concourse, or one of the lower levels up to the street level to get a cab. cabs. And we were laughing and talking and talking about, you know, in an excited way because of all the events of the day and how neat things were. So we're talking these things over. And there was this lone guy coming down the steps. And as he passed, he says, "Boy, it sounds like you guys are having fun." And I yelled back, "We sure are. Join us." And he jumped from one escalator to the other and came into the group. And we went on to the comedy club. One of the big ones, the one with the brick wall behind, improv.
Okay.
And it was packed. And they didn't have seats for all of us. So a young lady sat on my lap, and I was praying that the video camera, they were taping this for Shut TV, and I was praying, "Oh, I hope this is one my wife misses." Or don't pay in the audience. Nothing was going on, hon. Honest God. It was just shortage of seats. But this new guy had one of the female from our group sit on his lap. And a lot of us were doubling up so we could get to see this. Well, the upshot of this story is they fell in love and they got married. Isn't that? I just, you know, what we accomplish at these conferences is amazing. You got to come.
Yes, we learn a lot, and we meet a lot of people and network, and
wonderful people.
No telling where that all leads.
Yeah, wonderful people with a common purpose. You know, that makes for lifelong relationships, and that's one of the reasons. Like, I call this my professional home, and these are my brothers and my sisters, and some of them are my parents because they pretty much raised me to be the way I should be in this business. I came in ignorant, you know, and they've. I'm not like the Aud Lindsleys or the Tom Gilberts or the Joe Harlises who have created, or the Bob Makers, you know, the list goes on, who have created this business, this industry. I'm just a practitioner. But I'm a, he said without any humility at all, I'm a good one. And I'm good because of them.
Yes.
So this is a remarkable place to come. If you want to be an accomplished performance technologist, if you want to be an accomplished business person, if you want to be an accomplished consultant, come learn from other accomplished consultants.
Yes. That's... Tony, thank you very much for sharing some time with us and your insights and advice to others to explore this diverse world of human performance technology. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.